Speaker, my name is Cassandra Martinez, and I'm representing the economy. The plan: the United States federal government should substantially increase its economic and diplomatic engagement with the People's Republic of China over the implementation and enforcement of the agreement made at the 23rd Conference of Parties of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change in Paris through a bilateral framework. Over the years, public awareness of China's environmental issues have begun to reverberate. China is facing an air quality crisis. The concentration of hazardous particulate matter, known as PM2.5, since there are 2.5 micrometers in diameter or less, rose to nearly 20 times the safe level. Particulates of less than 2.5 micrometers in diameter are believed to pose the highest health risk, since they are small enough to seep into a person's lungs and bloodstream. The underlying factors that lead to this include widespread urbanization, dirty fossil fuels, and poorly regulated and polluting factories. People in China have begun to wear filter masks to stop air pollution from affecting their breathing. This is at the University of California, Berkeley, calculated that about 1.6 million people in China die each year from heart, lung, and stroke patterns because of incredibly polluted air, especially small particles of haze. China is the biggest gas emitter on Earth, and teaming up with them when they're shown signs of struggle can be beneficial to solving problems of climate change before it escalates to the point of no return. Inherency. President Trump doesn't believe in man-made climate change. He'll prevent enforcement of Paris Agreement goals in the U.S. This will collapse confidence and momentum, dooming global implementation, making warming of 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit inevitable. That before 2016. Mr. Trump has called human-caused climate change a hoax. He has vowed to dismantle the Environmental Protection Agency in almost every form. Global warming may indeed be the sharpest example of how policy in Washington will change under the Trump administration. President Obama said his efforts to establish the United States as a global leader in climate policy are his proudest legacy. Mr. Trump has already vowed to cancel last year's Paris Climate Agreement, which commits more than 190 countries to reduce their emissions of planet-warming carbon dioxide pollution, and to dismantle the Clean Power Plan, which are Obama's domestic climate change regulations. Mr. Trump cannot legally block other countries from fulfilling their Paris Agreement commitments, nor can he quickly or unilaterally release Mr. Obama's climate rules. But he can, as president, choose not to carry out the Paris Plan in the United States. That could doom the Paris Agreement's goal of reducing carbon dioxide emissions enough to stave off an atmospheric warming of at least 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, the point at which, many scientists say, the planet will be locked into an irreversible future of extreme and dangerous warming. That target is already extremely difficult to achieve, but it could be done very hard, very diligent work by every single country, Mr. Oppenheimer said. Pessimism appears to be warranted. Mr. Oppenheimer and other climate policy experts said all major emitters need to take action in the near term to stave off 3.6 degree increase. An analysis by the Climate Interactive, a scientific think tank that provides data used by many governments, concluded that the policies by the United States would account for 20% of the expected greenhouse gas reductions under the Paris Plan from 2016 to 2030. But absent the expected policy actions in the United States under the Trump administration, scientists at Climate Interactive said the math of emission reduction will be much more difficult to maintain. The Clean Power Plan is the ambitious centerpiece of Mr. Obama's climate change legacy and the key to his commitment under Paris Accord. Added to it is a set of Environmental Protection Agency regulations intended to curb planet warming pollution from coal-fired power plants. If enacted, the rules could transform the American electricity sector, close hundreds of coal-fired plants, and usher in the construction of vast new wind and solar farms. The plan is projected to cut United States power plant emissions 32% from 2005 levels to 2030. But the program is currently under litigation by 28 states and more than 100 companies, and is expected to go before the Supreme Court as early as next year. In China, the world's largest greenhouse gas polluters, climate change officials said they intended to continue the plans to cut carbon emissions regardless of Mr. Trump's plans. The Chinese president, Xi Jinping, has vowed under the Paris Agreement that Chinese emissions will drop after 2030 and that China will put in place a national system next year to force companies to pay a fee for the carbon pollution. China's attitude toward low carbon development, as Xi Jinping has said when he met with Secretary of State earlier, is that tackling climate change is not something anybody asks us to do. It's what we want to do. But in India, the world's third largest greenhouse gas polluter, the election of Mr. Trump has raised doubts about a willingness to move forward. Indian officials have made clear that their steps to cut emissions will depend on financial aid from rich countries, but Mr. Trump has vowed to cut all global warming payments. I think most certainly it will affect the momentum in negotiations because it throws up a lot of questions, said Anurupa Ghosh, Chief Executive on the Council of Energy, Environment, and Water, a New Delhi policy group. The chances of public funds coming from climate finance are much more useful now. Right now, I don't feel very optimistic. Advantages. Halting climate change now is crucial to keeping warming below 4 degrees Celsius. If left unchecked, warming will cause sea level rise, species loss, crop failures, threatening extinction, Plan 2014. In a 2012 report, the World Bank laid out a gamble implied by that target. As global warming approaches and exceeds 2 degrees Celsius, there's a risk of triggering nonlinear tipping elements. Examples include the disintegration of the West Antarctic ice sheet, leading to more rapid sea level rise, or large-scale Amazon dieback drastically affecting ecosystems, rivers, agriculture, energy production, and livelihoods. But the bigger problem, and the reason Copenhagen caused such great despair, is that because the governments did not agree to binding targets, they are free to pretty much ignore their commitments. Emissions are rising so rapidly that unless something radical changes with our economic structure, 2 degrees now looks like a utopian dream. Thank you.
Is process open or closed?
It's open, but I want everybody to attempt to try to answer a question before the partner comes in.
Do we have to work with China?
Yes, we are the two biggest greenhouse gas emitters, so it only makes sense.
Okay, is your plan plausible?
Yes, it is.
Okay, does China want to work with us?
Probably not, but with enough influence and recognition and word of mouth, I think we could convince them to.
Do we want to work with China?
Yeah, we do.
Okay. If China has already started making reductions to emissions, why do they have to work with us?
And you?
Okay, so in your source, you said China has already started making reductions to emissions. So why would they have to work with us if they're already doing their job?
Because the reduction emission, it's not enough to say that climate change isn't a big problem. And by us working together, the two biggest greenhouse gas emitters, as I said, it would make more sense to work with us than other smaller countries who contribute less.
Okay, also, theoretically speaking, when will your plan be implemented? Theoretically,
whenever it's approved.
So, theoretically, can you give us a year?
It depends on, of course, our spokesperson, the person who speaks for our country, President Trump. But hopefully it's not as soon as possible, so we can start kind of lining it down.
Thank you. Also, can I see the first page that you read?
Sure.
Can we look at it?
Thank you.
Can we get 1 minute of time?
It's about 30 seconds of processing.
Evidence of biodiversity loss from climate change, the IPCC retracted its findings about species loss in 2014. One recent article claimed that humans are turning the Earth into a lonely and very dangerous planet, but the bottom line is that the more we look, the more we find no evidence of this being related to global warming. This goes hand in hand with what we reported back in March. IPCC Administration from the report. No evidence climate change has led to even a single species becoming extinct, along with the snail that was supposed to be the first animal due to global warming that suddenly wasn't. From mammals to deep sea shark fossils spanning 5 continents and 2 oceans, these discoveries add to the family tree of life on Earth In 2014, researchers added a whopping 221 new planet animal species to our family tree. The results published in 64 different scientific papers helped advance the Academy's research into two of the most important scientific questions of our time. How did life evolve and how will it persist? Global action fails. The Paris Accord is just rhetoric. At best, it would reduce less than 0.5 degree warming by 2100, long before 2016. The Paris Accord talks a big game. The text says the world's leaders commit to keeping the increase well below 2 degrees Celsius, but this is just rhetoric. Peer-reviewed assessment of the Paris Agreement used the United Nations model to measure the impact of every nation fulfilling every major carbon-cutting promise in the treaty between now and 2030. I found that the total temperature reduction will just be 0.086 degrees Fahrenheit by 2100. Even if these promises were extended for 70 more years, then all the promises would reduce temperature rise by 0.3 degrees Fahrenheit by 2100. It's feeble, yet we hear claims that the treaty will do a lot more. We should check their mouths. Such claims are based on completely unrealistic scenarios, which governments do little now, but embark on incredibly ambitious carbon reduction policies after 2030. Given that it's hard to know whether the Paris Treaty will withstand the results even of this year's U.S. presidential election, it seems foolhardy to predict that the government will suddenly become dramatically more ambitious 15 years from now. Uniqueness. Japanese-American relations are rocky, but Trump and Abe come together on a tougher position against China and reasserting America's position in the region, Kelly 2016. U.S. President Donald Trump's meeting with Japanese Prime Minister Abe may mark the start of talks to garner Japan's support for a pushback against China's growing influence in Asia. In the face of rising China and on a volatile North Korea, Trump's campaign comments, including a demand that Japan pay more for the upkeep of U.S. forces on its soil, have worried Tokyo about a rift in security alliance with Washington that has been the bedrock of its defense since World War II. A tougher stance against China, however, and a call for Japan to play a bigger security role through a Trump-Abe axis would fit in Abe's hawkish policies that include allowing the military to operate more freely overseas. Trump was looking to Japan to play a more active role in Asia. Abe, he added, was a uniquely placed figure to offer leadership in the alliance. Senior U.S. Navy commanders have said they would welcome a joint air and sea patrol with Japan's military in the disputed South China Sea. Tokyo has balked at direct provocations of its neighbor, choosing instead to assist nations in the region with disputes with China, such as the Philippines. Trump, in his first 100 days in office, would end budget sequestration that mandates spending, including cuts in the military outlays, and submit a budget that would fund construction of dozens of new warships, the advisor said. It would send a message to Beijing, as well as allies, Japan and South Korea and other nations, that the U.S. is intent on being in Asia for a long time, he said. The larger concern is how they would be funded and how they would be manned. The official said that even if the funds were available, it would be necessary to find shipyards and skilled workers to build the ships. Trump would also need to overcome the reservations of fiscally conscious Freedom Caucus, Republicans who oppose increasing government spending, including at the Pentagon. The Trump advisor said that President-elect would want to allay the unfounded concerns Abe may have and affirm his commitment to their country's security alliance. This is going to be a respectful conversation. Potential friction between two countries, however, exists over how much Tokyo pays for the deployment of its U.S. forces in Japan. Japan says the funding it provides, which covers 3/4 of the cost, is enough. China's regional aggression has caused Japan to reject the Obama administration policy of engagement over issues like climate change in exchange for strategic reassertions, Funabashi 2016. With Japan hosting the Group 7 summit and China set to chair the 20 summit in September, this will be U.S. President Barack Obama's final visits to the two countries during his 8-year presidency. These visits will also be a test of how in sync the policies of the United States and Japan toward China really are. In the early days of Obama administration, the U.S. adopted a policy of accommodation and strategic reassurance towards China, revealing a clear gap between the China policies of Washington and Tokyo. This policy gap has now been in the past. The U.S. has switched to a policy of rebalancing in response to China's aggressive efforts to challenge the status quo in the South China Sea. In the past 2 years of this new period, Japan and the U.S. have also cooperated closely regarding the defense of the disputed Senkaku Islands. Notwithstanding these developments, beneath the surface, one can still detect a gap between the American and Japanese perceptions of an approach to China, namely, one, at present, the Obama administration finds it most difficult relationship to be with Russia, not China. However, China remains a primary contradiction for Japan's foreign and defense policies. U.S. leaders are well aware that China represents a greater long-term strategic risk. Two, With the U.S. government, there are two schools of thought on the proper approach to China. On one hand,
does climate change being more than a decade away make it less of a problem?
No.
So why should the U.S. like to combat this problem?
We should not be. The Atlanta Act is now, we're just saying that we should not be working with China.
Why not?
Because we already have a rough relationship with Japan, and if we do work with China, that can possibly destroy the relationship that we have with Japan.
So you're saying that it would make more sense to convince hundreds of other countries to compensate for the amount of gas emissions that China releases?
That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying there's, we can work with other countries or we can work on our own.
But it won't solve the problem as much as it would be to solve the problem in China.
Here's the thing though, China has already began, as you said before, to reduce their emissions. So I believe that we can do the same without putting our relationship with Japan in jeopardy.
But you previously stated that the decreasing emissions is not enough to be calling global warming not a problem. Alright. So you're saying that the US should combat this problem, but not with China?
Yes.
So, what countries do you propose that we work with?
We can work with ourselves. I mean, yes, we can work by ourselves. We can institute different forms of...
But would it add up enough to compensate for the amount that we could get done with China? Since China is the biggest gas emitter.
But here's the thing. China's taking on it by ourselves. And as you said, during your process, China does not want to work with us. Neither does our president want to work with China. So how is that going to play out? That's what I'm saying. And do we jeopardize our alliance with Japan and our position as a global world leader because we don't work with China, who does not want to work with us, by the way? And how, if they don't want to work with us, how will we work with them?
But the thing is, in recent years, we've worked with China. So
but that was for trade. Thank you.
Affirmative, do you need
a
question?
Hello, my name is Jessica Stark, and I'll be representing the affirmative. I'll be elaborating on what my partner said and also bring up and also go further for what she said, and I will also bring back what she also said. So we will start in contention two. Contention two is advantages. So where she left off was, we don't know exactly what a 40 degrees Celsius world would look like. But even the best case scenario is likely calamitous. Meaning, even if the best case scenario, meaning that all the other ones, this one, out of all the other problems that could happen, this one is the better of evils, it will still have dangerous effects. Meaning that no actual thing that would happen would be good for planet. 4 degrees of warming could raise global sea levels by one or even possibly 2 meters by 2100. This is bad for countries and states that are up below sea level, like Florida, like New York, or like Los Angeles. These countries are in danger because, as we know, they are surrounded by water and they are below sea level. So if the water rises, it can have dangerous effects. This would drown some island nations such as the Maldives and Tuvalu, which are countries that are below sea level. And in inundate many coastal areas from Ecuador and Brazil to Netherlands to much of California and the northeastern United States, as well as huge swaths of South and Southeast Asia. Major cities likely in jeopardy include Boston, New York, Great Los Angeles, Vancouver, London, Mumbai, Hong Kong, and Shanghai. And these are just some of the few. But when you think of what they just said in this, meaning that these cities and these countries, they are in danger. And if water rises or we don't stop the damage that's being done to our planet, they could suffer serious effects from us not caring. When you add ruinous hurricanes, raging wildfires, fishery collapses, widespread disruptions to water supply, infections and global-wide diseases to the mix, it becomes difficult to imagine that a peaceful world or society could be sustained. Meaning that if we do not take action now, we would not have all the things we have today. Global warming, if we do not take a stop to it, it would get worse and to the point where we can't even live on our own planet anymore. These air projections are equivalent to every alarm in your house going off simultaneously, and then every alarm on your street going off as well. And one by one, then they mean quite simply that climate change has become an existential crisis for human species, meaning that this is a chain of events. And if we don't stop it now, it can lead to more disastrous outcomes. And if we do not take action, that many other countries, not just countries, states and cities, or even countries that are below sea level, even well-off countries and states will have to be affected, not just by water, but also climate, by hurricanes or wildfires. You know, California is not just below sea level. It also has a lot of forests, and also it's really hot. So that is the perfect condition for wildfires. The vast majority of nuclear scientists never told us that we were almost certainly going to put our civilization in peril if we kept going out our daily life and as usual, doing exactly what we're already doing, which is what climate scientists have been telling us for years. Well, so for years, scientists have been telling us that if we keep doing what we're doing, that there will be a point where we cannot come back from what we have said already. If we don't stop, it might be too late to even reverse what we already put in place. President Trump's plan to withdraw from the Paris Agreement will pave the way for China to fill in the role as a global climate change leader. If the United States pulls out of the Paris Agreement, that means that we will no longer be the leader of the global climate change in China world. Because China is the second most powerful country in the world. So if we back out, then they will be. And we do not want that. The election of climate change skeptics Donald Trump has as president is likely to end the U.S. leadership role in the international fight against global warming and may lead to emergence of a new and unlikely champion, China, as I just stated. China worked closely with the administration of outgoing President Barack Obama to build a momentum ahead of 2015 Paris Agreement for climate change. Meaning former President Barack Obama was putting in place this so we can combat climate change. And if Donald Trump, our new president, decides to get rid of it, then we know this will be dangerous for not just America, but everybody who encompasses us. Beijing is poised to cash in the goodwill it could earn by taking on leadership and dealing with what for many of the governments is one of the most urgent issues on their agendas. Proactively taking action against climate change will improve China's international image and allow it to occupy the moral high ground, meaning it is in China's best interest to work on their emissions, if there are problems with emissions and CO2. Because as we know, China is the leader of global greenhouse gases. So it is in our best interest to work on all the pollution they put into the air. Xi Zhuhang is a representative of the Chinese delegation in this fight. Thank you.
Okay, so are China and America allies?
China and America are allies.
If the United States and China work together, how will Japan react?
It is for Japan's best interest not to engage with China. As we know, China is very powerful. And at the moment, Japan isn't in the right place to combat China if something like that would happen.
So they would just stay out of here?
They would stay out.
And will America and China working together stop sea level rise?
If China and America would work together, it would in fact hinder it, because they are, as my partner said, the two biggest producers of greenhouse gases. So if they work together, it will in fact slow down or even stop the progression of sea level rise.
Good afternoon, my name is Farhid Damani. I am the second affirmative constructive speaker, and I'm going to clarify our stance just for a minute. We are not saying that we shouldn't worry about global warming. Global warming is a problem. However, we want to reduce the impact of global warming, but we just don't want to do it with China. Because of friction with Japan, the implausibility of their plan, China does not want to work with us, and Xi will also face backlash. So So what do we plan? Our counter plan is to work by ourselves, because China does not want to work with us, neither do we want to work with China. So how will this happen? Well, here's the thing. China opposes efforts by the U.S. to control global warming by limiting Chinese emissions, Powell 2015. Despite increasing evidence that climate change is wreaking havoc, Luck spends about half his time in China. He says the phrase often heard behind doors in Beijing nowadays is environmental imperialism, a desire for the West to impose its environmental and energy use standards on the developing world. Basically saying that America is being a hypocrite, because while we have our own problems, we're growing and we're trying to solve their problems. And my opponent was saying that, you know, we have to work with China, and she did agree that they don't want to work with us. But here's the thing, we also do not want to work with them. Climate change, I'm pointing Donald Trump right now, climate change is a hoax created by the Chinese government. He said it, and some I might argue that he's not going to act upon it. However, his policies on the South Dakota pipeline and his action of defunding the NOAA have proven otherwise. Their plan is not going to solve global warming because it won't be implemented. The lack of real progress in the Paris Agreement proves that global action won't work. Wiseman and Evergreen 2016. Incremental, not transformative progress, although important building blocks may have been put in place, we are not necessarily convinced that this is a breakthrough agreement. We observe that the agreement does not contain more than vague indications of desired GHG emissions reductions in the long term. Stronger language would have sent a clearer message that business as usual cannot continue. However, no such signal was sent. And here's the thing, Paris was not a breakthrough, it was a saving face, CAS 2015. Negotiations worked late into the night. The hacking was not over how far to cut emissions. In fact, there was no negotiation over the emissions themselves. Instead, the U.S. fought with China and India over whether the latter two should even have to report transparently about their ever-rising emission levels. But celebrating the result as a breakthrough makes a mockery of the campaign to act on climate and insults the intelligence of millions of people. It's as if President Kennedy had quietly revised his vote to putting a man on my lawn. Negotiations could have redefined their goal to be achieving something like Paris, and they quickly reached it. This is called saving face, not saving the world. Not only that, but Xi, the president of China, will face backlash if he cooperates with the U.S. on climate change. Plans undermine push for economic reforms later 2016. Xi has turned his attention to the even more difficult task of delivering on those commitments that he calls green team. And I'm paraphrasing one of my sources, and he's trying to put like environmental policies, and they're working, but if he works for America, it's not going to work. And not only that, but Link, as my partner was saying before, China's regional aggression has caused Japan to reject the Obama administration policy of engagement over issues like climate change in exchange for strategic reassertions. At present, the Obama administration at that time found it most difficult relationship to be with Russia. However, China remains the primary contradiction for Japan's foreign and defense policy because they are our allies. U.S. leaders are well aware that China represents a greater long-term strategic risk. Within the U.S. government, there are two schools of thought on the proper approach to China. On one hand, the Pentagon are pushing for a stronger and clearer response to China's aggressive actions. Meanwhile, the White House would like to stabilize during Obama's time with China across all areas. However, many in the U.S. government have come to believe that deepening cooperation with China cannot happen and will directly benefit the global leadership. And here's our impact. A strong alliance with Japan is key to American global hegemonic power projection. It is vital to prevent a Chinese rise to power and collapse of the American alliance system. I can marry 2014. The American-led order in East Asia provides the foundation for the cascade of political and economic transitions that mark the region. These great transitions have served to transform and undermine America's own relationship with the region. The emerging order in East Asia is more multipolar and shaped by balance of power impulses. With the rise of China, the United States is no longer the only major great power in the region. And as you might know, we are fighting over the South China Sea because Japan and China need resources and those on the islands, the Senkaku Islands. But here's the thing. We are Japan's allies, and China is nuclearizing like no tomorrow, and China can nuke us. And we're not saying, oh my god, no, we should not focus on the Lord. We should, but maybe we should stop being hypocrites and focus on ourselves first. But if we fix the stuff in our country, like the South Dakota pipeline, like climate change and stuff in our country, then we could go outside. But if we do that, if we just work with China, tell them what to do, then here's what's going to happen. China's going to take advantage of that, and it's going to go over to the Senkaku Islands, the South China Sea,
and fight with Japan. And here's the thing, we're going to be in the middle because we're allies with Japan, but we're also working with China. So whose side do we take? And that could cause nuclear war on so many levels. And that impact is bigger. So we're not only solving global warming, which, by the way, their plan cannot really solve because it might not be implemented, but we're also trying to make sure that nuclear war will not happen. And in fact, if nuclear war does happen, that's a faster way of saying global warming is going to take over, you know, sea levels, radiation. Thank you. I stand ready for questions.
You stated that we shouldn't work with China. However, how do you respond to the common knowledge that are places in China where they have to wear masks outside due to large amounts of CO2?
But they're already placing restrictions and doing that by themselves, as you stated in your speech. And here's the thing, as I read in my source, she will face backlash if he cooperates. When they find out that we're doing with America, they're not going to...
You stated we shouldn't work with China, however... Oh, you stated we should focus on ourselves.
Yeah.
Is this the future of our planet not in our best interest? Is the future of our planet not in your best interest?
Okay, yes it is, but here's the thing, I also don't want like America looking like we're imposing imperialism, Western imperialism, like I read in my sources. Because if we can't solve the problems in our country and we're going and we're working with other countries, yet our own president does not want to solve our problems.
But is it really imperialism when it's not just U.S. and China working together, it's U.S., China, and 190 other countries working together.
As I said before, the Paris Treaty failed.
How did it fail if they didn't even put in place for it to fail in place?
But here's the thing, when President Barack Obama went last year, and in 2012, it didn't work out, he wasn't able to do anything that actually benefited him. As I said, in my source.
But don't you think now that the United States was willing to work with China, you just think it would be in our best interest for us to work with China because they are
just not. Our current president, as well as half of Congress, does not willingly want to work with China unless it's for trade.
Then what about the 190 other countries that are willing to work?
But that's okay. In your plan, you stated a bilateral framework, nothing to do with the Paris Treaty. I'm trying to say that the bilateral framework will not work.
But how is it going to be bilateral framework will not work?
Because if your plan is not even implemented, how will it work? If the current president of the United States is not for working with China, if China is not for working with us, then how will this entire thing make sense?
Saying the reasons as to why you should vote negative. So this plan cannot happen under new presidency. Donald Trump tweeted that climate change was a hoax created by the Chinese government. So this plan obviously cannot happen under a new presidency. China has already begun reducing emissions. Even without our help, they're still the largest greenhouse gas emitter. So even if they work alone, it will make a dramatic change. Also, why do we have to upset Japan? We're already on the rocks with them, and upsetting them can cause nuclear war, which will kill us faster than climate change. So there's really no need to upset Japan and for them to pro-lift. And like me and my partner have stated before, the Paris Treaty has failed before. And this can be shown through the record-breaking temperatures that happen every single year. This, like, last year we reached record-breaking temperatures. The year before, same thing. And China is not willing to work with us. We can't force them to work with us. We're not willing to work with them. So this plan will not be able to work if no one wants to work with each other. Okay, and she will face backlash if the U.S. cooperates with China, as my partner said. Okay, and I just want to reiterate this. Impact. A strong alliance with Japan is key to American global hegemonic power projection. It's vital to prevent a Chinese rise to power and collapse of the American alliance system. We cannot let them get control as the strongest country. The American-led order in East Asia provided the foundation for the cascade of political and economic transitions that have marked the region. These great transitions have served to transform and undermine America's old relationship with the region. The emerging order in East Asia is more multipolar and shaped by balance of power impulses. With the rise of China, the United States is no longer the only major great power in the region. Indeed, the rise of China is perhaps the defining drama of the East Asia and global order. Future decades will almost certainly see further increase in Chinese power and further expansion of its influence on the world stage. This is a power transition with far-reaching implications for America's strategic interests and global position. How the United States responds to growing Chinese power is, and will increasingly be, a seminal question of American grand strategy in the years ahead. Okay, and the Paris Treaty. The lack of real progress in the Paris Treaty proves that global action will not work, Boersma and Ebinger 16. Incremental, not transformative progress. Although important building blocks may have been put in place, we're not necessarily convinced that this is a first breakthrough agreement. We observe that the agreement doesn't contain more than vague indications of desired greenhouse gas reductions in the long term. Stronger language would have sent a clear message that business as usual can't continue, but there was no signal sent. And Paris was not a breakthrough, it was a saving phase, past 2015. As negotiators worked late into the night, the haggling was not over how far to put emissions. Instead, the U.S. fought with China and India over whether the latter two should even have to report transparency about their ever-rising emission levels. But celebrating the result as a breakthrough makes a mockery of the campaign to act on climate and insults intelligence of millions of people. So basically what I'm trying to say is that we should not work with China because our alliance with Japan will be on the rocks, which can cause nuclear war. Also, China is already decreasing their emissions and will make a dramatic change whether or not we work with them. We can work with ourselves. So if the United States as a country can barely take care of itself when it comes to global climate change, then what makes you think that this plan with China would work? Thank you.
Can I please have 3 minutes of my time? Thank
245 months, sorry, it's 315.
Notion that climate change is not a problem right now is absurd. It is important that we work with China. There are places in China where children and people in general have to wear masks in order to not breathe debris and other toxicities and air pollution. China is facing an immense air quality crisis. The concentration of hazardous particulate matter. Physicists at the University of California, Berkeley calculated that about 1.6 million people in China die each year from heart, lung, and stroke problems because of incredibly polluted air. This is not a domestic problem, it is a global problem. Climate change is happening, no matter how far away it may seem, it is happening. And my partner and I have previously stated, without acting now, future generations will not be able to thrive. Food supply will decline due to floods as a direct result of the Antarctic ice caps melting. The very air we need to survive will be toxic. Species will be lost. Everything we need to survive will be toxicized. And arguments made against acting now and with China, as made both by both my opponents and President Trump, will make it harder to fix in the future. Without thinking of the future of our society or our planet as a whole, economy and environment, it will be difficult to not make rash decisions that could actually affect current generations sooner than thought. The future is unknown, but that doesn't mean that we should hope for the best and wing it. We can't gamble on winging it because we don't know what's going to happen. We don't know exactly when global warming is going to catch up with us. So to work domestically makes no sense. We have to be cautious with our planet or we won't have a habitable one anymore. My opponent stated that we should act domestically, but should humans not come together from all over, we are facing the same problem, a common obstacle? Everyone on this planet can benefit from the agreement. There are no elaborated problems that have a significant amount of force behind them that should stop the government from funding the Paris climate. The plan. Working without China won't be nearly as productive as it would be to work with them. It would take at least all of the countries that agreed to the Paris Climate Accord to get half as much done as we would with China, because China is the biggest gas emitter. The future, my partner and I stress, is unpredictable. If one day the Earth turns into a toxic wasteland, we will have wished to have combated this problem head-on instead of letting it escalate to that degree. The Earth will die off one day, but the affirmative chooses to prolong it. Thank you.
How much I need the money, and I'm your second negative rebuttal. You should vote for the neg because A, our opponents dropped our she credibility, our Japan alliance, and as well as our proliferation argument. Also, our opponent in her rebuttal said that global warming will reduce the time we have on Earth. But you know what will do that faster? Nuclear war. And we have had multiple nuclear war scenarios that can happen if we work with China. A, Japan can pull up because they feel threatened, but thus working with China. Or B, China can pull up, which is actually more plausible, because if they want those resources in those islands and the Sunoco Islands, then they will pull up and they will take advantage of us working with them. C, China does not want to work with us. No matter how many times you state your plan and how many times you will say that, you know, there are a lot of people in China that are dying, they refuse to work with us. It is really sad that, you know, they're having this crisis, but they don't want to work with us, and they're doing it by themselves because they'd rather do it by themselves. Also, as we said many times, the Paris Accord is just rhetoric. At best, it will reduce less than 0.5 degrees warming by 2100. November 2016, the Paris Accord talks big game, like my partner said, and the text says the world's leaders commit to keeping the increase well below 2 degrees Celsius. But this is just rhetoric. My peer-reviewed assessment of national fulfilling every major carbon-cutting promise in the treaty between now and 2030 found that the total temperature reduction will be just 0.086 degrees Fahrenheit by 2100. Even if these promises were extended for 74 years, then all the promises would reduce the temperature by 0.3 degrees at the most, and Fahrenheit by 2100. That's feeble. Yet, we will hear claims. Such claims are based on completely unrealistic scenarios in which the governments do little now but embark on incredibly ambitious carbon reduction policies after 2030. Given that it's hard to know whether the Paris Treaty will withstand the results even of this year's U.S. presidential election, it seems foolhardy to predict that governments will suddenly become dramatically more ambitious 15 years from now. And not only that, as I said before, their plan cannot be implemented if the person running our country does not feel like it should. It's a policy, and the president obviously has to agree with it. If it can't work, it can't work. We don't want to work with them. They don't want to work with us because of us putting, like, doing a type of imperialism, as I stated before, Powell 2015. Despite increasing evidence that climate change is wreaking havoc, and China says that the phrase often heard behind closed doors in Beijing nowadays is environmental imperialism, a desire for the West to impose its environmental and energy use standards on the developing world. So here's the thing. If you want to avoid nuclear war scenario, and if you want to help reduce global warming in America first so that we can actually go out and help other countries by setting an example, then you should vote for a negative. Thank you.
Can I get that time? Okay, I'm ready.
First, I would like to clarify that our opponents are using the extreme nuclear war claim without any definitive evidence on this being the case. This is just speculation based off how Japan, America, and China relationships are set up. So how can we make an assumption off of something that we don't even have any evidence about? The negative side is very persistent on not working with China to conquer an issue that is affecting not just the U.S. and China, but the whole world. The negative has stated that Trump tweeting about the treaty shows his stance on climate change. However, President Trump tweeting is not more powerful than the United States government, which is supposed to work in the best favor of the people. This shows the disconnection that the president and the negative have with the people who see the problem. The negative stated, and I quote, "We're not saying we shouldn't work on it now. We are saying just not with China. However, They also stated that global warming isn't coming anytime soon, so there should be no reason to act on it now. The negative field realized that climate change is evident in the present. Ice caps, wildfires, and sea level rises are already happening. Just because you find 221 new species of plant and animals doesn't mean that already existing ones aren't dying because of changes to our ecosystem. The negative stated we should work on ourselves first. But this will put many different countries that depend on the U.S. to fight this problem in dangerous and advantageous positions. Not acting out is just another way to do more damage than we have already done. The point is, why wait? Why wait for something major to happen and be too late to do anything? We know global warming exists. We know it's happening, and we know that the effects of it now will be nothing compared to the future. People just have to wake up and see it. Thankfully, 190 countries chose to wake up and see the problem. That's why you should vote for our president. Thank you.